precious memories, unseen angels.
Of Mr. Gene Altree Crawford, and remember Brother Gene as a man of great strength, diligence, care, and love. And today we would also like to make this a worship service unto our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whom we have all hope and whom Brother Gene put all his hope in.
It's a pleasure.
And during this time, I would just like to open up with prayer. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we look to you. Father, we are reminded in your word. It says, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and stars which you have set in place, What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds, and the animals of the wild, the birds of the sky, and the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. And Father, we thank you for the name of Jesus. We thank you for Gene and God, how you blessed him. Lord, we ask that you would comfort his family today. And Lord, long after this day with the months and years, Lord, Father, we know that time has no meaning for you. Lord, you are timeless. God, our brother Gene is with you. And we pray all this in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. I wish to thank the family so much for allowing us this privilege and honor of loving you in this way. I had a family member last night just come up to me and give me the biggest hug, and she said, your church is so wonderful, y'all are doing so much for this family, and although I wanted to take all the credit, I couldn't, amen, I wouldn't be a good preacher, because there's been so many churches, and so many Christians, and so many people who have reached out to this family, who have fed them, who have called them, who have sent cards and texts and letters, and we just want to thank everybody who has poured love into this family, because Brother Gene, he lived a life of love. He lived a life that you could look at and wish to emulate. He was the kind of man you would long to be. And so as we say that, we want to thank everyone who traveled, who gave the gift of the journey. I was told that one of his nurses who kind of stood by him the last 13 years, she made the journey. I hear some people who are from a long distance, they made the journey, and I just want to thank you all for making the journey. That is part of the gift of love that you bring this family today, and I wish to read some scripture, and then the family has given me some things to read to you about Gene and about their love for him, but I would fail in this respect if I did not give you the comfort that God has given every one of us. Especially when we have such a loss in our life, when someone who's always been there is gone. I wish to extend to you the three great comforts God gives every one of us that walk upon this earth. He has given us the comfort of his word, the comfort of his spirit, and the comfort of his people, the church. And these three comforts can get you through much. His word says that there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. And it says in Ecclesiastes 3, I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it nor taken away from it. God has done this so that all of us should stand in awe of his creation. And I'm sure that you can understand in me saying that, that God gave Brother Gene his perfect season here in this life. He had the parents he was supposed to have, the sister he was supposed to have, the wife he was supposed to have, the children. Everything was a part of that perfect season and time for Brother Gene to experience what he experienced. Every time you had a conversation with him, God knew about it. When God said, let there be light, God already had in his mind that perfect season that Brother Gene would live. And so every one of these little divine moments that we had with Gene was a gift from God. And the season that he placed Gene in, I don't believe in accidents or coincidences. I believe in God. I believe he orchestrated Gene's life. And he put us in the good times and the bad times that we might even connect and care for one another. And I am certain that each one of you has received care from Brother Gene in all the seasons of his life. But God just doesn't speak us into existence and leave us alone. It says in Isaiah 43 that thus says the Lord who created you, who formed you, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Through rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Because you are precious in my sight, honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is that same God who gave him life, who gave him a season. And God's promise is that I'm just not going to create you and leave you alone. I'm going to walk with you through waters, rivers, and fires, through the hardship of life. I'm going to go with you. And I am certain if you guys really knew Mr. Jean, you know that Mr. Jean has been through waters, rivers, and fires. And some of the fires he started. If we're very honest, amen. But if you've been in different seasons of his life, he actually was the one who walked with you through your waters and rivers and fires. There have been times when he pulled you out of a situation that you couldn't get out by yourself. That was God's word made flesh. Because God, it wasn't satisfying enough to God to just have us here and him walk with us in spirit. It says in the Word that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and lived among us, and his name is Jesus. And this Word gave himself for us. In a very intimate setting at a dinner table, Jesus looked at them in John 14 and said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. And if I tell you, I tell you that where I go, that I may come and take you where I am. So where I am, there you may be too." And Thomas said, "But Lord, we don't know the way." And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And then Philip, the other disciple, said, "Well, Lord, show us the Father, and then that will be enough." And Jesus said, "Have you been with me this whole time, and you still say, 'Show us the Father'? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father and his love." And I want to venture to say this. If you got to experience Brother Gene, you got to experience God's love. If you got to go fishing with him, because if you got to go fishing with him, he loved you. Amen. Right? I bet he showed you his favorite spots. No fisherman does that often, you know. But he loved you. It says in 1 John chapter 4, "No one's ever seen God, but when we love one another, his love is made perfect in us. The Word became flesh, and my brother Gene was a word to many of you, a word of love, a word of humor, sometimes a word of reprimand." Amen. Brother Gene liked things done a certain way. I mean, I went into his man cave. Everything was lined up a certain way. And I think it's amazing that many of you last night wore shark teeth or arrowheads because he spent a great deal of time looking for things that are hard to find. But if we're very honest, he was a man. Today, it's hard to find a kind of man like that. Amen. I wanted to read you a scripture that Miss Pat wanted me to read to you. It says in 1 James chapter 2 through 7, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you can be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt. Because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord." And Ms. Pat writes this, "Gene was faced with a difficult trial in his life. Gene was not a man to let cancer defeat him. He would often say, 'It's just a thing.' He was a strong man that wouldn't give up and didn't give up. He was a man that didn't lack anything because he had God on his side. I am amazed and humbled because he knew God loved him. He knew God never left his side and was with him even when he was tossed around by the waves and the wind of his trial. He knew he didn't deserve anything from God, and he accepted what God gave him and stayed humble. He stood strong during the trials, and he won because he is resting in heaven." Amen. This is from the family. "The family would like to thank you all for coming today to honor Mr. Gene Crawford. At every funeral, you always hear about how great that person was or how they were one of a kind. But Mr. Gene truly was a man like no other, a hard-working man that provided all he could for his family and friends, a genuine and giving soul, but a truthful man that would tell you the truth whether you wanted to hear it or not. So if you thought he was your friend, he was your friend. Mr. Gene was a simple man, a man of little words, a private man, a proud man, and a man that didn't need much to be happy. He sure did have an impact on this world. He was an incredible man that loved his family and worked hard to provide for them. He was not afraid to get his hands dirty working. And let's be honest, he never stopped working, not even in the inn. But even though he was a very hard worker, he always made time for the most important things in his life, and that was making memories with his family and friends. Mr. Gene was an adventurous man that didn't have a lot to fear. And I'm going to be honest, I never saw him scared of anything, and if he was, he sure did hide it well. I have heard countless stories of him running from the law in his younger years. And he was apparently pretty good at it, because it took them many years before he was actually caught by local DNR. Now let me clarify, he didn't hurt anyone. He was not a thief nor a criminal. You think of when you hear that someone is running from the law. But he may have put himself through college and provided for his family by selling alligator hides on the black market. The local DNR saw he was so good at sneaking around the low country terrain that DNR offered him a job. I mean, after all, they discovered who he was because they saw the value in his skill and knowledge of the local swamps and land. Age was not a factor for this adventurous and fearless man. At the good old age of 77, he would still ride dirt bikes with Jackson, snow sled with the Grand Boys when South Carolina actually got enough snow, riding horses with friends and family, Nerf gun fights with Grand Boys, riding in the airboat down the Santee River with family and friends, and many more adventurous things. Even when he was faced with the diagnosis of cancer 12 years ago, that didn't stop him. The fearless and selfless man we honor today fought hard to be here for his family, never giving up. Because of his fight and strength, we are able to hold on to more memories in our hearts. Jackson writes, "I am thankful and will cherish forever the one-on-one time I got to spend with my granddaddy. I loved fishing with him and having that time this past summer with him as his first mate, but I will always cherish the golf cart rides around the property, killing squirrels with a shotgun." Amen. "When I missed a squirrel, he would always let me know by saying, 'I think you missed.' And when I accidentally would kill a dove, he would always say, 'Just don't let your me mama know.' And before going in for the night, he would share some stories from when he was around my age, which then he would follow up by saying, 'If I catch you doing these things when I did when I was your age, I'll blister your butt.'" Amen. And honestly, I know that Granddaddy would be out here teaching me and helping me do those things he threatened me not to do. Amen. This is from Eric. "I will always remember the times I got to spend with my granddaddy hunting together. I got to sit up in a deer stand with him and talk with him while we sat observing nature, watching birds and the deer." Thomas writes, "My favorite memory of granddaddy is when he built a wooden airplane swing for me and hooked it up to his horse walker machine. I got to fly around in a little airplane. He made a lot of things for us, such as a tire swing, tree houses, furniture. He put his love and care into every single thing he built, and I love him for that." Amber writes, "I'm so glad I got to share with Mr. Gene another passion of his, and that was the love of some good Southern food. Every time I look at that kitchen table, I will always be reminded of him sitting in his spot at the head of the table. I always sat next to him, and we would threaten each other if either of us looked at the other's plate, like we were warning each other not to attempt to steal the food off of each other's plate or something. He would eat in silence most of the time, with the occasional Now that is good. I know that he is sitting, I know that he isn't able to sit at his spot at the kitchen table here on earth anymore. But my heart is at peace knowing he is sitting at God's table in heaven, and I will get to eat beside him again one day. Brother Clayton writes, there is so much I could say about my dad and how I feel about him. He was my father, but most importantly, he was my best friend. He was a loyal man that would always say, I came with you, I leave with you. And he truly meant what he said. He was there for you no matter what, good or bad. You could always count on him. I just hope to be half the man that my father was. Sarah writes, Gene Crawford was a big family man and was never happier than when his children and grandchildren were with him. He loved his daughters-in-law, sometimes introducing us as his daughters. I will always miss hearing his greeting of, hey girl, whenever he would see you, always accompanied with a big hug. His son Gene writes, something that I will always remember about my dad is how he would drop whatever he was doing to come and help you. He was a true carpenter, always eager to come and build something for you. He built the deck off of my house, helped me fix doors. He built swing sets for his grandkids and many other things for us. He never did it in a way that made you feel like you owed him anything later. He just gave you his time and knowledge. He was always there for you when it counted. And Miss Pat, she writes, I will always remember how our lives began when we were dating. One early Saturday morning, you took me to Bono Dyke for a little joyride in the airboat. That really didn't go as planned. You were running full throttle and did a 360 to scare or impress me, which you did, but that trick didn't go as planned. Instead, the boat tipped, threw us both out into a foot of swampy alligator-infested waters, and then the boat turned around and ran me over. That's a good first date. I was not injured, thank goodness, just covered in swamp mud. And that's when I realized I love you and I was going to marry this idiot anyway. What a way to start our lives together. It sure has been a wild ride with a wonderful ride over the last 49 years. As we move forth with life, Mr. Gene will never be forgotten. You were the rock of this family. You hold a special place in our hearts, and we will hold on to your memories forever. The generation of men you have raised will carry on your morals and values through the next generation to come. I am not sure if Mr. Gene realized every person he touched or even realized every person that admired him, but we as his family see it and appreciate all the love that you have all shown us through this time. We know that he is looking down on us from heaven, and he is thankful for all the love and kindness everyone has shown. And amen. Family, I only got to be in Gene's life for this last season, but something that I saw when I walked into the home that he helped carve out with his hands and his love was that mantle over the fireplace. It was a piece of wood he pulled out from the waters, covered in grime, and he cut it, he smoothed it and cleaned it, and he repurposed it. And on that mantle, he has all these precious things, little memories. And one thing that's framed that says something to the gist of this, prayer makes a family strong. And I like that. Because my God's in the repurposing business too. He'll look at any mess, any problem, anything that's hopeless, and he says, I can repurpose that. I can make your hurt into healing. I can make your bitterness into joy. I can make you lost, and I can make you found. Amen. I love you, family, so much, and I thank you for this moment. Would you all pray with me? Lord Jesus, as we continue in the service, Father, I ask that you will continue to comfort us. And we thank you so much for the life that our brother Gene has lived. And Lord, he is still alive in you today. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
On that first boat ride, did that not set up a red flag? It's an honor for me to be here today. My name is Eric Sellers. I pastor in Blacksburg, South Carolina. And Gene's been a hero. He is a hero of mine. And so many times we got on an old boat together, and he would I buy stuff, and he said, "That's not going to work." My wife just asked me the other day, "What all this stuff right here you got? What are you going to do with it?" I said, "That's Gene's reject." He said, "It would never work, so throw it away, whatever you want to do with catfishing." So, but anyway, we say that we lost Gene. We didn't really lose Gene. Because when you lose something, you don't know where it's at. We just separated for a little while, and it's not a goodbye. It's just so long. Because Gene knowed who he believed in. He knew the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and a Savior of his soul. I could tell you many things. You talked about you never seen Gene in fear. Well, we seen him one time, didn't we, Wolfman? We seen him one time, and it's not been too awful long ago. We had a group out. We was fishing, and Linwood had called Robert to say it's getting pretty rough, y'all need to come in. But we thought Linwood was just trying to tell us that because we're going to catch more fish than Linwood. But we thought that was the deal. But anyway, we was coming in, Gene was leading the pack. He was up there, and I was second, and Wolfman was behind me. We was coming in right when you get into the many of you know, in the lower lake, when you go into the canal, it gets rough sometimes. Well, Gene was just cruising right along, and all of a sudden, I seen his boat. The whole front half of his boat was underwater. And I could see his prop sticking out of the water. And that thing jumped back like that. And man, it like scared me and Wolfman to death. And we went on in, and some guy got on his boat. He was mumbling. He said, "Lord, I know you weren't going to take me out like that. I just know you." He was talking to himself, this guy was. And I walked up on the boat to Gene, and Gene said, "Preacher," he called me either Preacher or Rev. He said, "Preacher, I would get up and give you a hug." He said, "But my hind end ain't going to let go of this seat right yet." But he'd always come up with something funny. And, you know, Gene Crawford was, he's right up there with John Wayne. Many of you know John Wayne. Some of these young ones don't know John Wayne. But Gene Crawford's right up there with John Wayne, the Duke. And if you could, he tell you something, you could bank on it. And many times we'd gather his boat or we'd go talk, and he'd always come in and he would always save his sandwich that he took out on the boat. He'd always save it till after the fishing was done. He'd sit down there and we'd go sit and talk to him. He'd eat his sandwich, we'd talk. And not too awful long ago, he had called me. I had started chemo, and he'd always call me. You know, I'd call him to check on him, but it wasn't about him. He'd always turn around, "How about you?" I said, "Gene, I called to check on you." He said, "Well, how you doing?" And I would tell him, and just like he said, you know, when I first started having to take chemo, he said, "Eric, it's just a thing." I said, "Wow, it's just a thing." And there's so many life lessons that Gene Crawford has taught me in the years that I've known him. And there's so many lessons that I know he taught y'all. I remember just the other day we was at hospice and they was talking about Clayton. Did y'all know that Clayton was a professional small engine builder? I mean, he can build a small engine. And they was telling the story that Clayton had a bad habit not checking oil in the lawnmowers. Clayton gets on the lawnmower and guess what happens? It blows up. Now, did Gene get mad? I thought, well, he just wore you out. No. What did Gene do? Gene taught him a lesson. He goes, buys the parts. 11-year-old boy now. Makes him tear down that engine out underneath the shade tree. And he made him put it back together. You check oil often now, right? See, these little things that we look over that we take for granted a lot of times is teaching us a lesson. And I remember one time, I don't know, but I'm bad about leaving my cell phone just where I'm at and don't know where it's at. And often it would be on Gene's boat before we go out in the morning. And he got where he went, he just come up and bring me my cell phone. And the last time he did that, he brought it up. And he said, "Here, son." He said, "I done raised two boys." He said, "Here's your cell phone." I said, "Well, thank you, Daddy." He said, he threw his hands up and he says, "I just don't know what I'm going to do with you." But you know, Gene was a great man, is a great man. I don't want to talk at him as he's in the past, because Gene Crawford, around 4 o'clock on Friday, he began to live. He began to go where we're will go one of these days when we leave this life. And it's you know, death is certain, just like taxes. Amen. It's certain. But you know, Psalm 47 says, or Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and strength. That's where Gene got his strength from. A very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried out into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof may roar and trouble, though the mountains shake, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. But the Bible tells us there is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God and the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. And God is in the midst of her. Gene Crawford didn't care nothing about no street of gold. Gene Crawford didn't care nothing about no mansion. But he knew his Jesus was there. That's what he longed for. And I know without a shadow of a doubt, came at Friday afternoon that he heard these words, "Enter in, thou good and faithful servant." There's so many things that I could stand up here and tell you about Gene Crawford. And it's these guys here. We have so many stories, but we can't tell them in here. But it wouldn't be good. But no, Gene was a great man. Many times he would text me and say, "Pray for my family." You know, it's often said about a man like that who loves his family as Gene loves you. And oftentimes I would get a request, "Preacher, pray for my family." Wouldn't tell me what was going on. He knew I didn't need to know. Just pray for him. And it's often said our greatest accomplishments, it's old Alan Jackson song, he said the man's greatest accomplishment is what he leaves behind. You. Jesus is the greatest accomplishment. And I know without a shadow of a doubt, I've already missed him. We all do. But I know I'm going to see him again because God said I would. And I just want to thank you again for this opportunity. He said do a few words, okay? So I don't want to make Gene mad. He'll whoop me when I get to heaven. But he said a few words. And I want you to know that I love you. And if I can be any service to you, don't down the road. I'm there. I was showing them boys that Gene's, I don't know how this happened. Maybe y'all can explain this to me. But ever since I had Gene's phone number, when I go to message, Gene's name is at the top of my phone. And it's in a circle. It says GC. I didn't put it there. But all this time, all I had to do is go to the front of my message, and Gene Crawford was the very first one. Nobody else's name's like that. But he's going to be missed. But you know, he left you far more than silver or gold. He left you that hope that knowing one of these days, if you know him free, pardon of sin, that you too will be there with him. Then what a time we're going to have in. I'm sure he done caught the first catfish out of the Crystal Sea. Amen. Showing them how to do it up there. And again, family, I thank you for allowing me to be a part of this. What an honor and privilege. I don't take it lightly. I love you. Let us pray. Father, again, God, I thank you for this opportunity, God, that we can come here today, God, and remember the life of Brother Gene, who touched so many in this congregation, and those who even couldn't be here today, God, there's so many that he touched. But God, I know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm going to see him again. God, I know that one of these days we're going to be once again together. And Father, we're going to worship you forever and ever and ever, for all eternity. Now, Father, I just ask you to be with us, his family. And God, give us that peace that passes all understanding only that you can give. And Father, for that, we're going to give you praise, honor, and glory. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
If God leads you, please come on down the road with us. But would you pray with me one more time? Father, as you guide us out, Lord, might you lead us, Lord. Father, we thank you for all the words that were shared, all the love we felt today. God, continue to bless this family and take care of them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.